I'm David Walton, and this is Diversity Dialogues. Hello, my name is David Walton, and I am the director of Western Carolina University's Global Black Studies Program, as well as an assistant professor of history. I would like to welcome you to another edition of our Diversity Dialogues podcast, produced by the University Communications and Marketing Office in partnership with the Office of Equal Opportunity and Diversity Programs. We hope you enjoy the show. Today, we're speaking with Dr. Travis Rountree, Assistant Professor of English Studies at Western Carolina University. And this is our Pride Month edition. And today we're going to be talking with Travis about his oral history project. So, Travis, tell us a little more about your oral history project, the name of it, and what exactly it encompasses.
Sure, yeah. And I want to thank y'all for having me here. And this is just a great sort of opportunity to talk about the project and talk about the collection. So the project really started with Sarah Steiner, who was over in Hunter Library. She started several years ago collecting oral narratives from drag performers in the area in Western Carolina and from, you know, from here in Jackson County all the way up to Buncombe, and just started kind of collecting their stories and that type of thing. And so so when I got here in 4 years ago, actually July 4th, I kind of wanted to start an archive as well, too. I'd started one in Indiana at Indiana University East and had started a sort of small one and did lots of events around that. And then when I came here, I kind of wanted to do the same thing. So I met up with Sarah and another colleague in the English Studies program, Aaron Callahan, and we kind of put our heads together and create a provost grant to raise money for the project and for student workers and, you know, materials and that type of thing. And so we got that grant, I believe, up spring of 2019, and then just like kind of got to work. And then of course that fall was the pandemic. So we had to figure out how to have my students go do interviews during a pandemic, but it actually turned out really well. Several students did those interviews. They also looked at a campus group, one of the first LGBTQ campus groups here, and did some work with that. Some works that were stuff that was published in the Western Carolinian, and so we got a lot of stuff out of that, as well as, you know, Sarah and Aaron and myself started to interview folks in the area as well too, and are still interviewing folks. So that's kind of the start of this. I've always been sort of interested in queer and LGBTQ archives, going back to my work at Louisville, where I worked with the Williams Nichols archive there at University of Louisville. And then that's when I started the one in Indiana, so in rural Indiana, which was fun, as you can imagine.
It was
great, though. It really was a wonderful experience. And I bought a poet that was from the area, from Richmond, Indiana, back home to read some of his poetry, which is really, really cool. It was really a lot of fun.
Awesome. Yeah. So with the oral history and oral collection, how far back does it go?
So great question. We have stuff from pretty much we have folks who are around here in the 80s. And then, you know, we have stuff that's very, very recent. But, you know, we just started recording for the project in that I believe it's fall 2020. Maybe we got one or two in spring 2019. But the sort of folks that we have in the collection were here during the 1980s and were actually in a group called Out in the Mountains. That was a local LGBTQ group that was kind of a closeted group a little bit, right? So folks would meet that were on campus or in the area and meet at someone's house or meet at a church here locally, St. John's Church, and just kind of gather and to get together and be around, you know, other LGBTQ folks. And so we're collecting more of those stories around that. And it's just, it's really, really kind of cool because we've always had a history here. Like, there's always been an LGBTQ history here. And just to hear those stories from way back when, and like, you know, that's during the AIDS epidemic and everything too. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Indeed. Did they reveal any pushback from the local community about the presence of LGBTQI people?
You know, it really depends on who you talk to. John Mealy is one of the folks that were in that group, and we have a really robust interview with him. He gave us a lot of information. It was so great to hear. I was like, oh my God. But it's just wonderful stories.
Yes, yes.
And he owned a shop in Dillsboro and with his partner, and he had a great experience here. Really, really wonderful, you know, and everybody sort of accepted him. There were other, you know, happenings in the, you know, I think it's kind of like it is too. The further out you got, the more sort of questionable acceptance would become. Marilyn Jody wrote a book called Letters to Emily, where she talks about teaching the first LGBTQ literature course in the English department here. And that book is just phenomenal about sort of the pushback, but also the danger for the students to be out, like as out in public. You know, right now we have some tremendous LGBTQ students here who are really radical and out and, like, you know, accepting and all that type of thing. But back then it was not her, you know, you were still closeted in a lot of ways. And so that book is just, and it's like, it's not too big, but it really sort of reveals a lot of the university life, but also the community life at the time too.
Indeed.
Indeed. So it was great.
Awesome. A lot certainly must have changed since those days.
Oh, yeah.
Because at Western, there's a strong, proud population. The intersections are remarkable. For example, the president of the Global Black Studies Club, she is an outed queer young lady, and many members of the GBS club are outed queer black men and women. So I was just really impressed with that and the bravery that they show.
Yeah.
Indeed.
It's amazing. I mean, even, you know, I'm 40 years old, but even coming up through high school and going to college and everything like that, like, a lot of people weren't out then, you know? And
indeed.
So now I'm blown away and just, you know, so grateful and honored to work with our students who are so out and you know, like not just out and kind of, you know, being quiet about, but they're out doing work too, doing community work, doing, you know, clubs and organizations and want to get involved with, you know, pride organizations and stuff like that. So that's really just tremendous. We have just amazing students here. I'm really,
indeed,
really, you know, grateful to be working here with them. Yeah.
As am I. As
yeah,
am I.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of intersections,
yeah.
What type of demographics were your collaborators? Because I don't like subjects or objects. Your collaborators.
I love that. Yes.
Indeed.
Yeah. Yeah. I love collaborators too. Yeah, absolutely. So most are white. Yes. Yeah. Most are cis white folks. We are making a big effort. We have a lot of, you know, other folks that are in the queue to be interviewed as well too. But I went to a really great presentation at RSA, that's the Rhetoric Society of America conference, where they presented on focusing on different voices and focusing on marginalized voices. And that's a step that we want to take the archive right now. I mean, we always want to collect because we're so small, right? We're not like Blue Ridge Pride's archive is huge and like it's a machine and I love it. And Amanda Ray, who runs that over there, is just tremendous and a mover and shaker. But we're still kind of getting everything together, but we are making a focus to collect Spanish-speaking folks as well as folks from the Koala boundary. So we really are trying to make a push to get those voices in the collection and to privilege those voices in the collection as well, too, because they've been here as well and are, you know, around now, too. And so we really want to start to collect more of those. That's our main push. That's our next sort of goal for the thing. And the other part is like, you know, you think about, I talked about out in the mountains, that group, like folks who are a little bit older or folks who have been here for a while, their stories are incredible. And, you know, not just for us, but I have students listen or read their stories and they're like, wow, like, you know, we had no idea. So it's been really cool. One thing, and I know I'll probably talk about this later, but with the Silver Pride work that I do, I'm the chair of that organization. But there's so many high school and middle school LGBTQ folks now, too. So to let them know that those voices were always here, too, and that there's, you know, allies here and community members here that are accepting and celebratory is really important, too. So I always kind of tell them, like, don't feel alone. We're everywhere.
Indeed. And that is extremely important.
Yeah.
And I don't believe many times people recognize the importance of just knowing that you're not alone.
Yes.
Knowing that there is an established community with history and heritage.
Yes.
Indeed. I often consider that when I think about Jackson County's African-American population.
Absolutely.
And So the work you all are doing is beyond important. It's vital for increasing acceptance, diversity, as well as humanity.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
At the university and in the region.
Sure.
And do you expect a lot of researchers to access and use the database?
I hope so. I mean, they're redoing the website now, so they're making it kind of pretty. He was nice earlier, but they're redoing a lot of those collections over there. So I do, we try to sort of showcase this as much as we can. Sarah and I talked to the Western Carolina Historical Association. We've talked to local churches here that are curious about what we're doing. And so I always also say that you know, a lot of this community work came out of the archive. So my work with Silver Pride and I'm on Blue Ridge Pride's board as well, too. You know, it was doing the archive that I saw the need for us to have a pride here. Yeah, I really would like folks to access it a bit more, and for us to have, like I said earlier, a lot more voices in there too. The sort of not so great part about this is that we at Western don't have a lot of room. So generally, in an archive like at Louisville's archive, they had like shelves of stuff, like tons. Like David Williams, like the way it came to be was his husband at the time, like, was like, you got to get all the stuff out of this house because it's like a hoarding situation. And so he literally brings carts of stuff still to the archive. But they have, you know, it's University of Louisville, so they have room for all that stuff. And they have, I mean, t-shirts and buttons and, you know, all kinds of, like a gay Monopoly game. And actually, just real quick, one quick anecdote, like when I brought my students up there, and I always want to have my students interact with the archive because archives are tangible and meant to be interacted with.
Indeed.
You know, and so I took my students up there, and the archivist or librarian there was just fantastic. She had all this stuff out, you know, and my students are like kind of sitting around cautious and like kind of looking around. And the archivist brought out this cookbook, and she was like, this is the 1984 Bears cookbook or Bear Man cookbook, you know. So and like, this is from Mr. Leather, 1989. So it was really a great moment because it was a great queer moment because the students were uncomfortable in learning about this new community that's always been there. And so it was uncomfortability is necessary in a lot of the stuff too, in the learning of it. So saying all of that, we at Western don't have a lot of room to store stuff. So that's not great, but you know, the oral histories are incredible. And I know Sarah and the folks at the library too are, you know, we can take digital photos of stuff too. And that's sometimes just as good and more accessible, right? For folks to get at it when they're, you know, on the computer or something like that. So,
yeah. No, that's so true. And, you know, with the changing and emerging technology.
Oh, yeah.
And helping researchers, particularly students, understand the creative ways you can approach primary sources.
Yes.
What is the importance or significance of the Oral History Project being based in the American South? C- covering the experiences of LGBTQI plus people in our area in Western North Carolina, but in the American South. Mm-hmm.
One, this is fairly new in the South and in Appalachia itself. Yeah, I mean, it's fairly new. I was just on a Zoom last night with the Appalachian. I'm also the vice president of the Appalachian Studies Association. And so we organized a Zoom on a book called All Means Y'all that's about queer Appalachian folks, right? And and that's new. And then another book that I'm in with my partner called Storytelling in Queer Storytelling in Appalachia. And that was published like last year, maybe 2 years ago. So in Appalachia, sort of a case study of the larger South. So there's a guy in Charlotte, Brian Bruford, who did oral histories there and actually started an archive at UNC Charlotte. And this is within the last like 10 years or so, right? So what we're seeing now is this growth and this like general like coming out of the South and of Appalachia. The literature has always kind of been there, going back to Dorothy Allison in the 90s, and maybe a little bit earlier. So we see these figures, and we see also these figures like Truman Capote, like that wrote, you know, a long time ago, but it was all kind of like secretive, right? You kind of knew, but you know, it was like so. But you see a lot more of overt stuff now, and there's so much great media out there, and documentaries like Small Town Gay Bar is a great documentary. Southern Comfort is one that I showed when I was at Indiana, and it's about a trans community who one of them has one of the folks in that community has cancer, and they kind of rally around that one person, and it is just like I showed it to my students, and we all just like cried. I was going to have a discussion. I was like, okay, none of us could talk, but that was done within the past 10 years or so too, and I think. You know, it's just sort of become a thing, especially now. Like, we just see it a lot more, which is great. You know, visibility is key in all the things. And I think along with the South, with those ideas, there's been a lot of work done on rural queerness. So, you know, you think of LGBTQ life, you think of, like, San Francisco or New York City or, like, these certain places. But now, like, there's a lot of work done on and like there's a podcast called Country Queers, which is like phenomenal. Like, it's so good. But you know, there's a lot of stuff being done now that ties not only the South, but also like, you know, rural North Dakota into all of that. And I'm not sure what the sort of spark was for that. You know, if it was like political. But it's a lot, and it's everywhere now too, and then all the media as well too. So
indeed,
yeah. But that's a great question.
Yeah, I often, particularly when I moved to Jackson County, and a couple of my friends who are also my colleagues pointed out places that like scenes for the film Deliverance were shot at, right? Now, I bring that up to say, because juxtaposing the horrible portrayal of queerness in Appalachia in that movie, and then the success in the contribution of Brokeback Mountain, for example.
Yes, yeah.
Right? So did anyone in the oral project, oral history project, did any of them mention either one of those two movies?
There was probably mentioning of Brokeback Mountain, but not Deliverance is a little dated now. So you'll see folks in Appalachians, and I've seen it. I haven't read the book, but I think I still own it somewhere. It's like a million books, of which I heard the book's, you know, not as bad as the movie. But yeah, you get a lot of like, and you know, the figure of the hillbilly, not only the hillbilly, but the queer hillbilly now. Comes out and is comes out. Sorry, that was not to
pun.
Oh my God! But you see a lot of the treatment of that figure now in literature, like I was talking about earlier. But you know, you see a lot more. I mean, like Deliverance, like horror movies, like that too. And I will say, a lot of this work that's happening right now is against. And I know we're already talking like politics stuff, but against J.D. Vance and his Indeed. Book that I won't even name because I read it and I refused to see the movie. So a lot of this work from the region is in response to that. And a lot of stuff like Dope Sick, like that show on Hulu is just it shows an honest depiction that's tragic of Appalachian folks. And there is some queerness in there too. Yeah. But it's such an honest depiction. It's hard to watch. I mean, it honestly is, but you see a lot of this sort of like, of this honesty instead of stereotype, you know, of the Indeed. Region for sure.
And that leads me to another question.
Mm-hmm.
How would you frame, or would it be appropriate to frame the Oral History Project as a form of resistance?
Ooh, I love that. Yes, 100%. Can we put that on our website?
yes.
I love that. I absolutely. I think all queer work is resistance work.
Awesome.
That's my little bumper sticker right there. All Appalachian queer work is resistance work. I think resistance work is unearthing a lot of voices that were oppressed or harmed or killed.
Mm-hmm. Because we got to be honest. And that was going to be my next question.
Yeah.
Are there stories, because I'm new to the area. I arrived 4th of July 2020 in the middle of the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm still fairly new to the area.
Mm-hmm.
Are there instances of those types of tragedies of queer people being murdered and abused, like, you know, like happened to African Americans with lynching and whatnot?
Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't have a lot. There's more suicide stories. I'll just be honest there. So in attempts at suicide stories. Yeah, and it's really hard to talk about. I mean, you talk about like in archival research, like it's emotional labor to do this. Like, and it's mm-hmm. emotional labor both for the folks telling the story, but for the folks gathering the story. And I'll say civil pride is too, because, you know, you get these younger folks who not ran away, but like left their house and didn't tell their parents that they came to pride, and this is their first pride. But yeah, we, and a lot of the Blue Ridge Pride collections has those stories too. One of the stories that I wrote a piece for Calliope Stage Company, that's a local stage company in Silva. And one of the folks I based my thing off of attempted to take their own life, but their friend stopped them. So, and one of our students played that. Scott McQueen played that role, and he was just, they were incredible in it, just incredible. There are tragic stories, but also, you know, there's also, I mean, this is Pride Month, so there's also celebratory stories too of folks who were successful and folks who made it and who are incredibly successful in the community.
When I was working on my dissertation, and half of it was based in South Africa, and when I was in the archives in Johannesburg reading the accounts of the students from the 1976 student uprising, the Black Consciousness Movement, but the stories they were telling about the torture at the hands of the state police in South Africa, I mean, I didn't realize how much it impacted me until I was riding a train from Johannesburg back to Pretoria. And I just started crying uncontrollably after hours of reading these accounts. And someone asked me, well, why did you put yourself through it? And I said, well, they told their stories, and their stories deserve to be told, right? And I thought of that when you were describing the suicide stories and the attempted suicide stories that do come up in the archives. I mean, because those young people and old people, those people, stories need to be told. And it's no telling the impact, the positive impact that can have on a young person or older person. But being specific to younger people, college students, high school, middle school students, you know, that, hey, people have experienced or gone through these challenges that I'm facing, do you feel that too is a form of resistance?
Yeah. I do. Just from folks learning about that and folks sharing their own story. And I don't think a lot of these collaborators, I love that word, I'm totally taking that out of here. I've used it before, but I think a lot of the collaborators like to share their story and their storytellers in and of themselves. But sometimes I don't think they understand like what an impact this has and what sharing a memory. I'm real big into memory studies and remembering in public memory, how these act as places of public memory, but also as pieces of activism as well, too. And pieces of hope, to be quite honest, just like what you were saying. You know, someone could read this, or one of our students could access this, or a high schooler, and be like, oh my gosh, like, people like me have been around forever here, or at least since the 80s. But really, true, forever, because you yes. have, you know, a lot of Cherokee folks. Like, I really want to learn more about that. And I know some about it, but I really want to learn more and read more about the history and read more about the, culture of Cherokee two-spirited people, Cherokee queer people, because that's, you know, a big part of this area. Obviously it is this area, period.
Indeed.
So, I think here at Western, we had, an indigenous queer person come talk in, I think it was 2 years ago, maybe. And just incredible. Just the knowledge, that the stuff that I learned from like just a little hour webinar was just so great. So I really want to sort of push down on that and go that direction with this archive as well, too. The tribe did vote no on the same-sex marriage there. So that's how New Dali Identity started to form. Against that vote, that was one of the main reasons there. And we collaborate with them on a lot of different things as well too. It's incredible to have people in this area that support, you know, us and our community.
So, indeed. Yeah. And once again, we see resistance mm-hmm. in those Cherokee folk who are queer or allies, mm-hmm. you know, organizing themselves to resist
yes.
against the politics, mm-hmm. right? Because culturally, as you said, two-spirited people and et cetera, it's something that has been prevalent and mm-hmm. present in Cherokee culture. Mm-hmm. But the politics today are impacting decisions by leadership.
Yes. A lot of colonialism has impacted that. A lot of evangelical religion has impacted that. Just from my limited knowledge, two-spirited folks were revered and shamans and like a lot of different things like that. That's just my limited knowledge that I know. And I say that like as a white man, that's all I know about that. And I need to read more, and I will read more to educate myself. It's been really wonderful. Yeah, working with all those folks and to fold us all together into this community. And I'd like to expand Pride out. Pride is like, you know, the event, which is great and fun and like lovely. But I really want to expand our event out to include bringing local folks here to tell their stories, like the Oral History Project, you know, here at Western, but to have local folks come tell their stories about, like, even if they just moved here, right? Where this is where I'm from, this is how I'm fitting in this community, this is what I like to do here. Or folks who have been here for a long time and say, hey, you know, this is how it was in the 80s. This is, you know, what it was like during the AIDS epidemic here. At Indiana, I had to put a panel together of local activist folks. And I had a nurse there that worked at the local hospital during the AIDS epidemic too. And just, I mean, she could hardly even talk about it, as you can imagine. It was a lot of emotional labor. It's important. That history is important here, you know, so.
Now, because I am Mr. Controversy. Okay. So what would be your response as a queer man, as someone involved in these projects and institutions and activities, if someone said, well, it's none of our business, keep it to yourself, or why do you got to tell me? Why do I got to know about Blase Splee, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera?
Well, my answer would be controversial too, because I would be like, you probably have one of us in your family.
Indeed.
chances are, or you are one of us. But
indeed,
I would say this is, and I would go at that from a historical perspective and say this is a piece of history. This is a piece of Western North Carolina's history that has been hushed, that has been put under, just like, you know, all history that's happened here. This is stuff that needs to be unearthed, shared. You know, this is a part of our identity here, like it or not. This is a part of the community here. And you can't argue with history, you know, like
indeed.
Argue with people's experiences, with things that have happened. And I would also say, you know, we're all humans. These are stories. These are, you know, just like you grew up with stories about Christmas or grew up from stories with your grandparents. Like, these are stories from, you know, your neighbors, your garbage person, your teacher. You know, these are stories from folks that you know. And if you really are part of this community, then it's important for you to listen and hear.
Indeed.
And acknowledge that, acknowledge these identities and celebrate them too. But there's different... I'm part of the safe zone thing, so there's like different levels of celebrating, you know, LGBTQ
yes.
identities. But I think listening is the first big one. And even myself as a queer person, like that's my big, well, of course with the oral history stuff, but just to listen. And that's really the most important thing, to be honest. And especially something I've learned during the pandemic too. Folks just want to talk and tell their story. And sometimes a listening ear is more powerful than you trying to fix their issue.
Indeed. So. And every faculty and staff member should get the safe zone training. I did it at UNC Pembroke when I was faculty there, so I need to upgrade or get a refresher at Western. Now, and I just wanted to say that to all the faculty and staff that are listening, right? We're here to serve students, and that will help better prepare you to serve our student population. Now, since I've been at Western Carolina University, I've met and talked with maybe about 7 reformed white nationalists.
Wow.
My students. And then one is a neighbor of mine, a close friend of mine. And those who, as a result of my classes, have began the process, and then some have began the process on their own and just coming across and meeting with me and being able to consistently talk with me about things, mm-hmm. they say has helped them in their rehabilitation mm-hmm. process. Mm-hmm. That in therapy, because they all said they go to therapy, right? Because they were raised as white nationalists.
Yes. Yes.
And I, you know, it's it's part of the region where we live in, if we're being honest. Mm-hmm. So I said that to ask you, have you encounter people who have shifted their view, their understanding towards LGBTQI people as a result of interacting with you, the Oral History Project, your classes, anything?
I don't think anyone's been flat out like, I was a homophobe, like, and after this, like, you know. But I do see, talking to a lot of folks in the community, some folks who are less comfortable, let's just say, than others, and talking to those less comfortable folks who, and then saying, like, go talk to somebody, read something, go watch Pose, go watch. I mean, we have Netflix, there's stuff everywhere. Educate yourself. And generally, us queer folks watch that stuff too. And so you can have a discussion. Oh my God, did you see the new episode? Blah, 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 blah. That type of thing. I think it's been just sort of smaller acts of like, oh wow, like I didn't even know what a pride was. Like, this is, you know, that type of thing. I think working with a lot of, I will say that the civil police has been incredible. And they say Pride is their favorite event because we have our stuff together. I almost said another word. But we do. Like, I'm a very organized person. I have to be. But, you know, I think from what they've heard too, luckily, we've just had, last year we had just small incidents. We had, like, you know, the preacher guy on the corner who's going to be at every single pride. That's not going to not happen. Like, just expect it, you know, whatever. Everybody's got their right to talk in free speech. But for the most part, we've had a positive response. Just the community businesses, too, have been really supportive as well, too. I want to kind of acknowledge that. And we kind of see who is really supportive of us in the Silva community as well, too, business-wise.
That's great. That's wonderful. Because as we make a push to increase our student population, as well as to maintain and expand our student demographics, it's extremely valuable and important for students to be aware of the existence of the project, of those institutions, those community-based institutions. And I believe it will help more students become interested in attending Western Carolina University, particularly knowing the cultural politics of the state that we live in.
Yes, indeed. Very much so. Yeah. I think, you know, even high schoolers and middle schoolers in the area, talking to, you know, some of the groups here have started to do work with those groups and acknowledging that this is a thing that exists at Western, bringing, you know, even local students here, or, like, you know, talking to them about Asheville and stuff, too. Is really important. And yeah, I think it is important to get the word out in our, to our incoming students as well, too, for these opportunities. Because honestly, like, we can use volunteers for the archive a little bit, too. But, like, Silver Pride, and there's lots of other, there's Silver Pride, there's New Dahlia Dentetti on the boundary. And then there's Silver Queer Support and Education, which is kind of like a PFLAG organization. And all of us, you know, all work together very successfully. We all do sort of different things. Silver Pride's more like an event, sort of like we host a pride and organize a pride and are going to pay people this year. Yay! So, awesome. So nobody's holding a hat. I mean, they could still do that if they want. I mean, they're drag performers, so they will. But I mean, we can always, you know, we always love to have support from students and stuff too here. That it's interesting too, those organizations, because they all formed during the pandemic too. And I think in a lot of, one question I often get is like, why did this happen? And so I think with a lot of the sort of like the Black Lives Matter movement and a lot of the sort of unrest that came out of that and a lot of this, you know, it was a great civil uprising. And that's sort of one of the effects from that. I'm honored to have been a part of that and to kind of have the privilege to serve in this role too, to be an advocate for folks in this area and folks who are going to move here too. So I'm definitely, and do not take that for granted ever.
Indeed. Now, how can faculty and staff help or support the project?
So I think using it in their classrooms, you know, from just exposing students to pieces of the project, to reading it, to analyzing it, to contributing to it. We love to have faculty. We love to have more faculty. We love to have more students. It's the Jackson County collection of the archive, but we want students and faculty. I mean, anybody that lives here, we want in the archive. If they're willing to share their story, we want to collaborate with them, right? So that's one really good way that they can contribute to, and just kind of spread the word. We're pretty small, but we have a we usually get a student worker, and so we'd love to have more and more. And I actually wrote down where we are with the project because Sarah couldn't be here, sadly. But we've had 3 student employees. We've created workflows, website, and metadata schemata, which is like all kinds of library talk. So it's big and fancy web page. I'm like, oh, this is impressive.
Indeed.
We've recorded almost 40 oral history narratives and posted 52 Western Carolina articles on the first LGBTQ campus group. And then we're going after those, or we really want to like collaborate with those other identities that I talked about earlier. I mean, that's sort of our priority now to do that. And kind of spread it too. Like we have a lot of folks from Jackson, but you know, we're looking to gather some folks from further west too.
Awesome. Awesome.
Yeah.
And our community is growing. Mm-hmm. I know we have a new librarian, a friend of mine, and she's an outed queer black woman.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, and she just got hired in July. No, not July, because it is June still, May. And she went to undergrad at Western.
Oh, really? Oh, yes. Okay. Well, yes. Yeah, I really want to collaborate with her a lot to see how it was. Yeah, indeed. That's great. I think this is going to start growing. I mean, even since I've only been here for 4 years, but even since I've been here, I see more and more sort of things happening on campus. And it's great.
Indeed.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing a lot of student support from, you know, with the cisgendered heterosexual community,
yes.
But a lot of support. I know it was some weird stuff that made to an entertainment station that will not be named. Mm-hmm. And just the way that I witnessed with my own eyes, mm-hmm. students rallying support around the community.
Yes.
It was very, very refreshing.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the talk around that and the handling of that, I think is really critical and important students are our number one priority here, obviously, but also to faculty and staff, like
yes.
to LGBTQ faculty and staff, because that statement was really like kind of intense, you know, but yeah, our administration has been really supportive, the chancellor all the way to the provost and our dean. And I felt supported all the way up the line. Chancellor Brown has talked to, I'm on the LGBTQ working group. She's talked to us a couple of times as well too. And, has always been really supportive. Provost Starnes has been incredible too with supporting in like any way, but he's like, what can I do? How can I help? So it's not just, you know, with Western, but also with Civil Pride stuff. Like it's been really great to have that support. Cause you know, I mean, yeah, it's important work. You know, like you were saying too.
Well, you and your colleagues definitely do a lot of great work. You and your community partners do a lot of great work. Please continue to do the great work. It's a positive impact and influence in the region as well as for our campus community. So I want to thank you on behalf of the campus community for the work that you all are doing and have done. And I want to give you opportunity to maybe give us any last thoughts or words of encouragement or anything you feel would be good parting words.
Cool. Well, I appreciate that. It is like kind of my life's work to do this. Besides, I love teaching. I love teaching and I love researching and writing, that type of thing. Like, that's my sort of persona. But like, this is, advocacy has become a big part of my life right now. And I really appreciate those words and the support. I don't want to ever say like, ever not say like, the support of this university has been tremendous, all the way from the English Studies program, from my department chair, Brent, all the way, the dean and provost and the chancellor. So I do want to acknowledge all of the work that they've put towards the archive to give us the provost grant that we earned the provost grant, all the way up to Silva Pride stuff. I guess last words is, come to Pride. One, like, happy Pride. It is June. Woo! I wish I had, like, confetti. I need to put a confetti can or something in my next grant. Like, woo! So happy Pride. But also, you know, for us to acknowledge and remember what the meaning behind Pride is. And we can have fun in that type of thing, but it's also honoring folks at Stonewall and honoring that movement and who we are and who we continue to be and acknowledging that history and past, which is what the archive does, but also looking towards the future, which is what our students do and are. And yeah, that's pretty much. Yeah, I think. Thank you again for having me. This was fun.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to Diversity Dialogues, produced by Western Carolina University. For more content, visit go.wcu.edu/podcasts.